Good afternoon, everybody. So today we're going to go over Staphylococcus aureus, which is a common foodborne pathogen. So we'll go over some background information first. So Staphylococcus aureus is a gram-positive cocci. It is also a facultative anaerobe that is halotolerant and can survive in salt concentrations of up to 10%. It can also produce toxins. Its presence in food is generally an indication of poor sanitation because it's vulnerable to almost all sanitizers and highly vulnerable to destruction by heating. However, the toxin is not vulnerable to destruction by heating. Therefore, it's really, really important that we work to keep staph out of food in the first place. This is important to note as about a fourth to a third of all people carry staph in their nose and or skin. So food manufacturers and food handlers need to make sure that they're practicing good hygiene. So how do we test for Staphylococcus aureus in food? So the main medium that we use is Baird Parker agar. It is a selective medium that helps to select for staphylococci. However, it's solely used for the isolation of Staphylococcus aureus. This is because coagulase negative staphylococci cannot grow well on this medium. One of the ingredients is egg yolk, which is the substrate that allows us to detect lecithinase production and lipase activity. The tellurite ingredient acts as a selective agent, and due to its reduction, staphylococci will produce dark gray to black colonies. Interestingly, strains that are isolated from frozen or desiccated food that have been stored for long periods of time frequently develop less black coloration than typical colonies. They may also have a rough appearance and dry texture. When you go to incubate these plates, the Baird Parker plates should be incubated at 35 to 37 C for about 48 hours. So here's just a picture of the Baird Parker agar. You can see that these clear zones around the colonies are what is showing the lecithinase production. And then this opaque zone of precipitation is showing the lipase activity. And then you have the little black colonies that show the tellurite reduction. Also, Staphylococcus aureus is generally perceived as pretty small on plates as well. So another way you can enumerate Staphylococcus aureus is using the Staph Express system that Petrifilm has, or the 3M Petrifilm brand has. This Petrifilm contains a chromogenic modified Baird Parker medium that is selective and differential for Staphylococcus aureus, but it may also indicate for Staphylococcus hyacus or Staphylococcus intermedius. These red violet colonies are considered the enumerable colonies, and that's what you should consider as Staphylococcus aureus. Now, we're going to go into biochemical testing, and the reason that this Staph Express system is considered a system is that there's more than one plate. So you have the plates that we just went over, but then you have this Petrifilm disc. So if there are colonies other than red-violet that are present on your original Staphylococcus aureus Petrifilm plate, you should use this Express disc that comes with the plate. So blue-green colonies are not typically considered Staphylococcus aureus, but they may hide Staph aureus. So it's important to use this disc then. Black colonies you may also see, and they may or may not be Staphylococcus aureus, but that's where this disc comes in handy. So they contain toluidine blue O and DNA. DNA's positive bacteria degrades DNA that reacts with the toluidine blue O to form pink colonies. Staphylococcus aureus is positive for DNAs, as are most coagulase positive staphylococci. So these DNA's negative colonies will not produce pink zones. So our DNA's positive colonies are these pink ones with the pink zones that I'm circling. And you can see the rest of them around the page. So those you would consider as Staphylococcus aureus. And then I'll change colors. Do you see these like little blue-green colonies throughout? These are not considered Staphylococcus aureus. They're probably another staph species. And so they don't produce that DNase activity, and so they would be considered DNase negative. So then we'll move on to mannitol salt agar, which is abbreviated as MSA. It's used to determine whether or not staphylococci can ferment mannitol. It has a high salt concentration of 7.5%, which helps to select for staphylococci as well. The medium contains phenol red, which we've seen in other mediums before. Because the main carbohydrate in this agar is mannitol, when the agar turns yellow, the agar turns yellow in acidic conditions due to the phenol red, like those created when mannitol is fermented. So when it turns yellow, we can assume that the carbohydrate mannitol, which is in this medium, so when it turns yellow, that we are fermenting mannitol. The agar will stay red when the bacterium does not ferment mannitol, because there are other carbohydrates for bacterium to ferment in this specific medium. Over 90% of Staphylococcus aureus strains do ferment mannitol, so we typically consider it as a mannitol fermenter. So then we're going to move to the coagulase test, which is really, really important in the detection of Staphylococcus aureus. So the coagulase test identifies whether an organism produces the exoenzyme coagulase, which causes the fibrin in blood plasma to clot. The coagulase test is used to identify the presence of bound coagulase, which is attached to the bacterial cell wall. This bound coagulase reacts with the fibrinogen in plasma, and this causes precipitation. The cells then agglutinate, providing the clumped together appearance that you see right here. You'll be able to conduct this test in a virtual lab exercise on Blackboard. And just as a side note, you should never use colonies from the MSA agar, as the high salt content can create false positives. If you don't have time to wait for the actual coagulase test, you can do a latex agglutination test like we did with Campylobacter. This test is a little bit faster than the actual coagulase test. There's two different ways you can conduct a coagulase test besides the latex agglutination. You can either do this on a slide like you see above, or you can do it in a tube as you see in this picture below, where you'll see this clumping together in the tube when it's tilted. You'll be able to do the slide version in the lab, and then the tube version is up on a video in Blackboard as well. So then we have the catalase test, and any bacterium that uses oxygen gas or can live in the presence of oxygen gas has to have a way to get rid of hydrogen peroxide because it's a potent oxidizer. One way to do this is to make catalase, which is an enzyme that breaks down the hydrogen peroxide into water and oxygen gas. Have you ever cleaned out your wound that you've had with hydrogen peroxide? You may have noticed white bubbling within that wound. This is due to the evolution of the oxygen gas as the peroxide is being broken down. So Staphylococcus aureus is catalase positive, and you can see the presence of bubbling when you put it in the presence of hydrogen peroxide. You'll have the opportunity to do this in a virtual lab on Blackboard. And you can also, just like the coagulase test, you can do this on a slide or you can do it in a tube. The last inferential test we're going to talk about is the novobicin sensitivity test. So novobicin is an antibiotic that binds to DNA gyrase and blocks ATPase activity. Staphylococcus aureus is known to be sensitive to novobicin. And we'll discuss antibiotic susceptibility more in depth during a different lab later in the semester, but briefly to give you an overview, to conduct this sensitivity test, you would streak Staphylococcus aureus all over a Mueller-Hinton agar plate. You'd then add a novobicin disc, which is this little white tablet looking thing right here, to the plate to see which organism is able to grow in its presence. You then incubate the plate for 24 hours between 35 and 37 degrees C before checking your results. In the Staphylococcus aureus plate above, which is this plate on the right, you can see that there is a zone of inhibition. That's the zone where you don't see any bacteria growing around the white disk. You then measure the diameter of this zone, and sensitive bacterium have a zone that is 16 millimeters or greater, which indicates it being sensitive. All right. So In the Blackboard folder, you guys will have, there's three different videos for you guys to look at going through some of these tests. There's another one that goes with blood agar. There's also two virtual labs for coagulase and the catalase test that allows you to actually do the lab on Staphylococcus aureus. So I would definitely go through and do all of those. There may be questions about them in the quiz, but thank you so much. I hope you guys are having a good day.